Amen. This morning, praise God, He has made us a tabernacle that He might dwell in because we're washed by the blood of Jesus. Can I hear an amen this morning for that? Praise God. Would you stand together with the choir and the praise team as we rejoice in what our Jesus has done for us? He came. He died on the cross to cover our sin by His blood, and then He rose again. We're going to rejoice this morning that this day is the day that He made. Oh, oh, oh.
So much more, knowing that all you have in store for me
is good, it's good.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I
says just that. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. He has called us to worship Him and to rejoice in every day He gives us, standing on His truth. And thank God for His truth. Follow after me as I sing this line.
I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
And all my days I'll live for you.
And all my days I'll live for you.
And I will stand upon your truth.
And I will stand upon your truth.
And all my days I'll live for you.
All my days
in your heart.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it.
Today is the day that we follow Him. And thank the Lord that He calls us. He guides us. When we falter, He's the one who picks us up. We can't follow Him on our own and in our own strength, but we only follow by the power of the Spirit that indwells us. But He is the one who gives us victory. Thank God for that. We must turn to His Word every day for guidance, for strength, for understanding how to walk this life that He's called us to and He's redeemed us to live by. When we open the Word of God, what happens, church?
God speaks.
And I hope that you know you need to open your heart to Him as He speaks to you so that He can change each one of us. Well, let's read His Word together this morning and allow Him to speak to us. Every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the hearts. To do righteousness and justice is more acceptable to the Lord than sacrifice. And you know what we tend to do? We tend to get into this idea that, Lord, when I sacrifice more, God's going to bless me more. And that's not what God desires. He doesn't desire just the giving without the heart. He doesn't desire us to make a sacrifice and not have our hearts in it, not be right with Him. And so He calls us to obey first and then to sacrifice. As we continue to worship, let's put our trust in Jesus and thank Him that He's the one that guides us to trust Him, to surrender all to Him. He wants our hearts, not our pocketbooks, not even our effort. Let's continue to worship Him.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word. Just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord.
Oh, it's sweet to put our trust in Him.
Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood. Just in simple faith to plunge me beneath the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, for grace to trust Him more. Yes, 'tis sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Yes, we need His grace every day to trust Him. We thank Him for that day when we will see Him on the other shore.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for singing this morning. You may be seated.
That's good. Thank you, Lord, this morning for His grace that brings us each and every day here to worship and throughout the day to worship the Lord and give thanks for all the goodness that He has for you and I, that forgiveness that we experience, and knowing each day, your day, my day, can be governed by Him, and it can be a great day. And so we come to Him now as we just pause for a moment to bring our burdens and say, God, I want to trust you. Oh, for the grace to trust you more. And maybe this morning you have a burden that you need to lay on the altar and say, Lord, I need to trust you in this situation. I need to trust you with this outcome. I need to trust you in this way. And so this is when we pause to do precisely that. He is one that we can trust in. Praise the Lord this morning. He's faithful and true to His word, to all of His promises. And so we can believe in what He has told us. And we can rest in that this morning. And we worship Him when we do precisely that. So I want to invite you this morning to join with me here on the altar. We're praying for others in our church family that need God's healing touch, like Brother Don Johnson and Crystal Moss, Donovan Campbell and Lane Pierman, others that you know of. We want to intercede and pray for them, but also we want to bring our burdens before the Lord, praising Him that He is a trustworthy one to rest in, to trust in, but also saying, God, these are the burdens that you know about. He's well aware of them, but He wants you and I to acknowledge we need Him. We can't navigate this life without Him. And so let's bring our burdens, let's lay Him at His altar, and let's pray that our worship today will be from hearts that trust Him and that, oh, that will trust Him more. So let's pray this morning. Father, we give thanks today that, Lord, there is one we can look to, a faithful, a merciful high priest who intercedes for us. And Lord Jesus, we thank you that you will be with us to the end. That we can trust in you, rest in you, bring our burdens to you, cast our cares on you, Lord, knowing, Lord, when we do that, you're governing our day, you're in control of it, you're working things together for good. Father, we lose sight of that sometimes. Forgive us, even this week, Lord, when we've done that. And God, help us to be reminded as we gather now to worship you that, Lord, our hearts should be surrendered, yielded to you, delighting in you, Lord, desiring to do what your word teaches us and guiding us and directing us for every step of life on this earth. Father, we pray today for some brothers and sisters that just need your healing touch. And so we lift Lane and Donovan, Crystal and Don before you and pray your healing touch upon them. God, we pray for, Lord, those that we're burdened about, Lord. There are unspoken needs that are in our hearts today that, Lord, we know you know about, but Father, we pray that you would tend grace and mercy in those situations, Lord, that you would supply what is needed. And Lord, for the things we're wrestling with today, God, right now, may we just resolve to give those to you, to rest that our God is in control, Lord. We don't have to hold on. It's in your hands, and we can trust you to work your good purposes in our life. Lord, put a desire in our heart to obey, to follow you, to go where you command us to go, to do what you command us to do, to find delight in doing it, Lord. And in all of it, Lord, simply to bring glory and honor to your name. For there's no name like yours, Jesus, and it's sweet to trust in you. And so we do that today, and we thank you that our worship directed to the Father through you, empowered by your Spirit, can be well-pleasing. And may that be the case today, we ask all powerful name of Jesus, our Savior and our coming King. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Amen. Again, welcome to worship this morning. It's good to see you in God's house as we gather to celebrate our great God. And if you're visiting with us this morning, you're our special guest. So I'm going to ask you, if you don't mind for a moment, just remain seated because our church family wants to welcome you into the house of the Lord. And also, our ushers have a card they want to share with you. And I have some information I'd love to give you at the end of the service. But I'm going to ask all of our South River family right now to stand to greet one another in the name of the Lord. And if you see a guest seated around you, please take a moment and welcome them this morning into God's house as we gather for worship. So South River family, you stand.
All right. Thanks for welcoming one another. Guess you can stand with us. And let's gather back together to worship. We're going to rejoice in the faithfulness, the goodness, the grace of our God this morning. Lift your voice and praise Him.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough. Justice, God. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us with the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along.
So remember, Lord.
So remember.
On us every day. Thank you, Lord. Your grace is enough. Let's pray and let's thank Him. Lord, we thank You today. Thank You that Your grace, Your goodness, as Your word says, goodness and mercy follows us. It nips at our heels day after day. Lord, thank You for that faithfulness that You pour out on us. Thank You, Lord, for the grace by which we're saved and the grace that we have every day. Now, Lord, I pray as we give today, help us to give our lives first and then our offering. But, Lord, may our offering go thankfully, Lord, to spread the gospel through this community and throughout the world. That truth, the Lord, Your grace is extended to whosoever will may come. Thank you, Lord, and we love you. In Jesus' mighty and matchless name, amen. You can be seated. Sing that chorus one more time slowly.
Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is mine.
the Lord. He is our life. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, praise team. Children, you're dismissed with Pastor Scott to Children's Church this morning. I invite everyone to grab your Bibles this morning and wants to be first, right? Amen. The first will be last and the last will be first. Amen. Amen. You got your Bibles this morning. We're discovering how Jesus is our life and the doctrine of godliness becoming more and more like Him. And I want you to turn with me to that book of wisdom over there, Proverbs chapter 21. We're going to start there and then flip over to the left to the book of 1 Samuel and see where this wisdom that Solomon gives us this morning is actually illustrated for us through something that his daddy knew about because it affected King Saul. Last week we saw, listen, there's only two paths in life, the wise path and the foolish path. And you have to choose which one you're going to go down. And that's really God's way or man's way at the end of the day. As parents, we learned last week, of course, we want to raise our children to choose the wise path. Amen. But our Father in heaven, listen, I speak today not to the children, but to God's children. The Father wants His children to choose the wise path. He wants us to choose the right path. He wants us to go in the right way, and the right way is going His way. I know as a dad, sometimes it's easy for me to be worried about my children's obedience because, you know what, I want them to obey. Sometimes it's out of my own pride that I want them to get it right every time because I think, you know, they're a reflection of me, and that can be wrong, the wrong motivation for obedience. Sometimes, you know, we estimate our values before others and before God that, you know, their obedience in some way is a reflection on us. And that's true in some ways, but also we realize, you know what? They do have their own will to make their own choices. And so as a parent, I want to raise them to govern their own hearts. And learning that is learning God's authority in their life to govern their hearts and for them to realize they need to be under His authority. And I know there's safety in obedience. There's a reason why we want them to obey, moms and dads. It's why we're guiding them. We're not just their friend. We're their parent. We're God's authority in their life, guiding them, directing them to obey. And what we realize is as that obedience is made manifest in their life, in our life, what it is a testimony, listen, that we belong to Him. We are children of heaven and not sons of disobedience, as Paul would say over in Ephesians chapter 2. Sons of darkness, that's what we once were. The verse we're reading today is a simple principle. You'll find it all throughout Scripture, and I'm going to highlight it over in 1 Samuel in a little bit and some other verses. But this passage talks about obedience being better. Better than what? Better than sacrificing. Why is that the case? Well, you know, when you study God's Word, what we discover is, do you realize the first sacrifice that had to be offered was offered because of man's disobedience in the Garden of Eden when Adam sinned? God had to offer a sacrifice because of man's disobedience. God had given a command, Adam disobeyed it, and there were consequences. The wages of sin is death. Something died because of man's disobedience. So a covering could be made for the man and for the woman. What you find all throughout Scripture in the sacrificial system and other things is that what you see is that God allows sacrifice to take place so we can approach Him, but always it's because of man's disobedience. It's because man has to acknowledge, you know what, I didn't do the right thing. I didn't do the just thing. And I need some provision for my disobedience. I don't want to pay the consequences for that sin. And so by faith, I'm trusting God in a sacrifice that can be offered in my place. What God desires, and we're going to read here, is obedience. What God wants in your heart and my heart. Listen, it's not just in our children. As God's children, what He wants each and every day is for us to walk in obedience, allowing Him to govern our day, guide our day, direct our steps, and finding the joy, listen, in choosing God's right paths. And we need to do that more and more each and every day. I confess, listen, as a saved believer, listen, sometimes it's difficult. My flesh doesn't want to obey God. How about yours? Can I get an amen? Amen. And if it's not, it's oh my. You know, it's stepping on my toes this morning because you know what? God's word is crystal clear. This is what He desires. And so in Proverbs, here's the simple wisdom. We're going to look at it briefly and then flip over to 1 Samuel 15. So hold your place here, and in a minute we'll jump over there as well. But I want you to stand and hear this simple wisdom. We've already read it this morning. This is something, it's a phrase. Listen, I say it with my kids oftentimes. Sometimes they say, oh, Dad, I'll do what you want me to do. I'll sacrifice for you. No, no, no. I want you to obey. I want you to obey joyfully, not begrudgingly. I want you to obey completely. I want you to obey the first time with a happy heart. It'll be better for you, son, if you'll learn this principle. Listen to what it says. Every way of a man is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the hearts. To do righteousness and justice, those are the right things, is more acceptable to the Lord than to sacrifice. Father, help us to understand this principle. Please etch it on our hearts tonight, this morning rather. Etch it on our minds, Lord, that our life will be governed by a joyful delight to obey. May it be the reflection of hearts that love you, that find great joy in you and realize that your ways are far better than what we think is right. God, forgive us, Lord, when we don't choose the right way, when we don't obey. Thank you, Jesus, that you provided a provision for us by your obedience for all of our disobedience so that we can even now come and approach a holy God and experience his grace and mercy through your obedience. Lord, I pray you'd speak to our hearts today and our lives would be transformed. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. You may be seated this morning. This proverb is very simple wisdom for us. It's really clear. It's really honest for you and I just to evaluate our hearts. But if we're honest, it's difficult to do it. You know, life centers on two little letters, I and F. If I choose this, if I choose that, that's the way it goes, right? Life is about which choices we make, which path we make. We choose if we go one way, if we go another way. God's desire for us is that we walk the path of righteousness. I mean, a good shepherd guides us in paths of righteousness each day. Now, oftentimes, let's be honest, we think we're going the right way. Now, brides, please don't elbow your husband at this point, but every man often thinks we're going the right way. Amen? Yes, we do. Every way of man is right in his own eyes. We can find reasons to justify why we do what we do. We can make good reasons for this is the right thing. It's the right way. And I know it. But you know, the Lord, he knows the motives. He knows our hearts. He knows what's behind every decision that you and I make. Our hearts are exposed to him. They're revealed to him. They're open before him. He sees what's motivating us to go down that particular path, to choose that particular choice. But God wants us to do the right thing. God wants us to do the just thing. The right thing is what he defines as right and what he defines as wrong. He's clear in that. He is not ambiguous in that. God is a God of light. He makes those things known. He helps us to see. It's his plumb line which helps us to reveal what's on the right side, what's on the wrong side. He knows what he shows and defines what is the just thing to do. Not as the world defines justice, that social justice stuff. Listen, biblical justice is what we're after. We want to do what's right and what's just in his eyes. And what God wants is for you and I to desire to do that more than merely bring a sacrifice. Why wouldn't God want a sacrifice from us? Well, here's the problem. Oftentimes, we don't do the right thing, and so we'll say, well, I'll just sacrifice this to God, and that'll be sufficient. But what God wants is not just some external act of worship without a heart internally that is yielded to him, that desires to obey what he says. Remember, listen, it was the first sacrifice that was offered because of man's disobedience. The sacrificial system established so that men could bring their offering to God. Listen, lay their hand on that sacrifice and realize, I disobeyed. I need forgiveness. I didn't do the right thing as God defines it. I didn't do the just thing as God defines it. That's sin, and there's a consequence for that. And I'm trusting, I'm putting my faith in God to be gracious and merciful and accept my sacrifice. If the heart behind that sacrifice isn't honest with the Lord, isn't yearning to do the right thing, then God really doesn't want that sacrifice. What God wants is obedience. He'll say this over and over again in the minor prophets, in the Old Testament. In fact, over in Hosea 6:6, it says this, "For I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings." What is love? Well, Jesus said love is what? Love is obedience. The fruit of love, what love produces, is obedience. If you love me, Jesus said, you will what? Keep my commandments. I mean, it's the Great Commission. We baptize people in the name of the Father, and Son, and the Holy Spirit and teach them to obey all that Christ has commanded. Not merely teach them all that Christ has commanded us and taught us, but teach us to obey it, to observe it, to do it, to realize this is the right way. This is the right way to experience God's blessings in life. I've chosen the wrong way too many times and experienced the consequences of that. I don't want to keep going down that path. God, change my heart. Put that desire in my heart to do the right thing for the right reason, with the right aim, and with the right motive. You know, when David sinned against God, you know what he wrote over in Psalm 51? Listen to this in Psalm 51, 16 and 17. This is his great confession. He wrote two songs confessing and repenting of his sin because he didn't do the right thing. And he said, "For you, God, do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise." When my heart is broken before God, listen, when my heart is yielded to God, when my heart realizes God knows the best for me and I need to surrender and do what God says, I'm delighting to do His will. And that is a sacrifice in and of itself by my obedience. And that's what God wants. Now, David knew this, not only in his own life and his sin, but he also knew that from the life of King Saul before him. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 15 this morning. This is where we see an illustration of this played out in the history of God's people with the first king that they had, Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 15. Now, the background of this is this. God led his people out of bondage in Egypt. They were on their way, making their way to the promised land. And as they were going, they were raided by the Amalekites. The Amalekites, listen, they were a ruthless tribe. And they attacked the stragglers, those at the back of the train heading towards the promised land. And they killed many of the stragglers in the convoy heading to the promised land. It was so bad over in Exodus 17 that God began to teach his people, listen, I'll fight your battles for you if you'll let me, and here's how I'm going to fight this battle. Moses, I want you to send Joshua into this battle against the Amalekites, and you find a vantage point. And I want you, Moses, just to raise that rod up. And while you raise that rod up during this battle, as long as that rod is raised up high, the rod of the Lord, there'll be victory for God's people. But the moment Moses would lower his arms, it would appear that the Amalekites were having and prevailing against God's people. And so what happened is Aaron and Hur came and lifted up Moses' arms. Moses sat on a rock and enabled his hands to be held up. And as long as that rod stayed up, God provided the battle victory for his people in that battle. As a consequence of what happened, God told Moses, he gave him a promise in Deuteronomy chapter 25. He said, listen, I'm going to utterly blot out the Amalekites because of their sin. It would be many years until God fulfilled that promise, and that's right here what he intends to do through King Saul. And so what Saul needed to learn, what we need to learn, and this is an illustration for us today, that simple wisdom that Solomon gives us is this. Listen, to obey is better than sacrifice. Why? Well, you see, obedience, when I obey, I'm living for God's purposes, not my own. God's purposes, not my own. Saul is given the command by Samuel, the prophet of God. The Lord is coming to him, and the Lord says to him, listen, I want you to punish Amalek for what he has done, verse 2, to Israel, how he ambushed them on the way when they came up from Egypt. Go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have, and do not spare them. Kill both man and woman, infant and nursing child, ox, sheep, camel, and donkey. So Saul gathered the people together and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 foot soldiers and 10,000 men of Judah. Saul came to a city of Amalek and lay in wait in the valley. Then Saul said to the Canaanites, "Go, depart from among the Amalekites, and I will, lest I destroy you with them, for you showed kindness to all the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt." So the Canaanites departed from among the Amalekites. And Saul attacked the Amalekites from Havilah all the way to Shur, which is east of Egypt. He took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive, and utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. Notice this. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep, the oxen, the fatlings, the lambs, and all that was good, and were unwilling to utterly destroy them. But everything they despised and worthless, that they utterly destroyed. What happened? Saul's to execute God's judgment now on the Amalekites. God had given Amalekites many, many years to repent and get right with him. They didn't do that. And so the delayed fulfillment of God's judgment is now upon them, upon these raiders that have always been a thorn in the flesh of God's people. And so Samuel, the prophet, comes and gives the command to Saul. This is what God says you should do. Utterly destroy. Complete judgment. The same phrase that's used over in the book of Joshua when they went into the promised land and were to utterly destroy all those things which were contrary to God. Saul is given the privilege, King Saul is given the privilege to fulfill God's word, to be on divine mission. And this is a mission which is serious because there's severe consequences. He is going to annihilate the entire peoples of the Amalekites. But we see his disobedience in verse 8 and verse 9. Verse 9 defines it this way: Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep, the oxen, the fatlings, the lambs, all those things. What did they do? They anything that was good, they didn't destroy them. Why? Why didn't they destroy them? Why didn't they do exactly what God says? To obey God is better than partial obedience. Saul and his men did destroy many of the worthless things, many of the despised things, but they didn't completely obey God. They spared the good. They kept the good, actually, for themselves. They went out, they waged war, they did what God commanded. We went out and we fought against them, and they rewarded themselves, but they only obeyed God partly. When God speaks to us, what God commands us is, listen, God wants us to obey him completely. He wants us to obey him with the right attitude, the right heart behind it, whether there's a reward or not that we see visibly, tangibly or not. I mean, if they were going to destroy most of the individuals that go out to war, they get a reward for that. They get something from the battle they take home with them. But in this battle, God says, no, you take nothing that they have to offer when you destroy them. You destroy all of it. And what true obedience understands is this: we do the thing, listen, because it's right in God's eyes, not simply for the reward. We do what's right in God's eyes so that we can obey him, not because we get something out of it. And see, we're privileged to serve our Father in the same way each and every day, simply doing his reward. He is enough for us, at least it should be that way. Now, he does, listen, those who come to him by faith, we do have to believe that he is, and he rewards those who seek him. But the reward, listen, is not just some streets of gold and a mansion in heaven. The reward is God himself, which he wants to give us. And we learn to obey because what we want is to live for his purposes and not for our own. To live for his glory and not for our own. That's what happened. Notice in verse 10 through 15. The word of the Lord came to Samuel. God speaks to his prophet and says, I greatly regret that I have set up Saul as king. Why? Because he's turned back from following me and has not performed my commandments. And it grieved Samuel, and he cried out to the Lord all night. So when Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul, it was told to Samuel, saying, Saul went to Carmel. And indeed, notice this, I underlined it in my Bible. He has set up a monument for himself. And he's gone on around, passed by, and gone down to Gilgal. Samuel went there to Saul, and Saul said to him, "Blessed are you of the Lord. I have performed the commandment of the Lord." Has he? Yes, he has destroyed the Amalekites, but not completely. He did obey. He went immediately when God told him to go. He went into battle. He went, numbered his troops, took them with him, went into battle, and fought against the Amalekites and brought the sword to them. But he hasn't obeyed completely. In fact, what he did was he evidently wasn't living for God's glory but for his own. Because after the battle, what did he do? He set up a monument for himself. Why? Why does he need to erect a monument? Well, this is the first king that God's people have had. And in some sense, evidently, pride has gotten a hold of his heart in some way. And so he elevates himself and he builds this monument for himself in evidence that he's deceived by his own accomplishments. Not realizing that it's always God's favor that secures our success. It's God's favor upon us that ensures that you and I thrive and are blessed in our battles and the things that we do. He owed everything to God, but he doesn't appreciate what God has done evidently for him. Even when Samuel, the prophet, comes and speaks to him, notice in verse 14, "What then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears, this lowing of the oxen which I hear?" And Saul said to him, "They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God, and the rest we have utterly destroyed." Did you notice what he says right there in verse 15? To sacrifice to the Lord your God, and the rest we have utterly destroyed. Evidently, the misplacement of his understanding of God's favor upon thinking that he accomplished these things, he set up a monument to himself to make a name for himself and not for his God. Evidently, he's growing impatient even with God's authority, God's prophet Samuel, because he says, "Listen, I've destroyed, look at this, we destroyed everything, but we kept the best, and now look at this, we're going to offer it to your God." You can see almost the sneer on his face. It's no small thing to do what God says, to obey him. But if you and I don't do it for the right reason, God is not honored. And what we realize is Saul really doesn't fear God. He fears those around him. In fact, that's what it says from verse 16 through 21. Samuel said to Saul, "Be quiet!" Exclamation point. In other words, Samuel sees right through this. "And I will tell you what the Lord said to me last night." And he said to him, "Well, speak on." So Samuel said, "When you were little in your own eyes, when you were not the head of the tribes of Israel, were you not? And did not the Lord among you make you king, anoint you king over Israel? But now the Lord sent you on a mission and said, 'Go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they are consumed.' Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Why did you swoop down on the spoil and do evil in the sight of the Lord?" So Samuel confronts Saul and says, "Oh, you were given this opportunity and you did not do precisely what God says. And because of that, God now is going to judge you. Why? Because you didn't fear God. You didn't fear God. You didn't obey the voice of the Lord," verse 19. Saul said to Samuel, "I have obeyed the voice of the Lord," verse 20, "and gone on the mission on which the Lord sent me. And here it is, I brought back Agag, king of Amalek, and I have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But it was the people who took the plunder, the sheep and the oxen, the best of the things which should have been utterly destroyed to sacrifice to the Lord." Here it is again, "your God, in Gilgal." Saul is making excuses now. He's making excuses to the prophet Samuel. He's making excuses. "Listen, God's orders were clear. I did what you said. Look, can't you see I've destroyed all these Amalekites and I've only brought back King Agag and the best. But it really wasn't me who did this. It was the people who did this." His obedience, listen, what Saul has chosen to do was because he feared the people more than he feared God. Remember what the proverb said, "Every way is right in every man's eyes. But the Lord does what? He checks the heart. He sees the motives." Listen, when we make decisions in life, if we go down this path or that path, and we say, "No, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this what God says. But if we don't stay clearly on that path, if we waver just a little bit off that path and then get back on it, waver just a little bit and just divert our direction just a little bit, God wants complete obedience from my heart and your heart. Understand that this morning. In fact, as I teach your kids, this is the parenting principles. Hey, mom and dad, listen. This is really important because we're training their hearts for heaven. We're training their hearts for him. And how we do that is this. When the child is given a command, an instruction, something that God wants them to do, why does God want them to do it? Because you are God's authority in their life. God placed you there. He gave you and trusted that child to you. When God gives you that responsibility and you and I instruct our children in the right ways, we tell them the right thing to do, and we want them to have obedience the first time. We want them to immediately go and do it. We need to train them to do that so that, like you and I right now, when God speaks to us, we immediately do what he says. We don't waver in that. We don't, I don't know. I don't want to do that, Lord. We train their hearts now, and we continue to train our own hearts to obey the Lord the first time. But also not just to obey him the first time, but when he gives us an instruction, it's not just to do it the first time, but to do it completely, to do it thoroughly. And as we're training our children, raising them up this way, teaching them to obey, we teach them this because it's what's going to help them in life under God's authority when they're not under our roof anymore, to learn that. And not just to do it the first time God says it, but to do it with a joyful heart. Listen, there's many times that our kids, that we tell them to do things and they do, I'll go do it. You know what I'm talking about? Come on. Yes, I'll do it because you told me. No. God wants us to learn to delight to do his will, to find joy in doing it. Why? Because it's the right thing that God has told us to do. And this is what we train their hearts. So listen, so we're training them for heaven because it should be a reflection of our hearts. They should see in you and in me a desire to do God's will the first time completely with a joyful heart. And that's what Saul didn't demonstrate. He didn't demonstrate complete obedience. He didn't even demonstrate joy in doing it, at least joy in doing it for the Lord's purposes in the Lord's name. He was doing it evidently for his own name. Notice the monument he made in his own name. He was doing it for his own reward. Look at the pleasure, all the good things that they kept for themselves in not completely obeying the Lord. God hates disobedience. Why? Because at the end of the day, it's misplaced fear. You're not listening to him. We're not listening to his voice. We're fearing the human consequences of a decision that we might make when we should fear the consequences of disobeying the Father in heaven. And Saul does that. But we should delight in God's authority in our life. And that's what the prophet says to him. Look at those in verse 22 and 23 when Samuel responds to him. Has the Lord, here it is, as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. I underline that. And to heed than the fat of rams. Why is it better to obey? Why is it better to offer up obedience, your heart, my heart, surrender to the Lord, delighting to do what God says? Why? Because this is the recognition of his authority in our life. And it is not, listen, idolatry to worship or yield to another authority in our life. How do I know that? Well, look at what he says. Verse 23, rebellion, that's disobedience. That is, listen, doing what I want to do, not what God wants me to do. Rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. And stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you've rejected the word of the Lord, he's also rejected you from being king. You see, when I delight in God's authority, and listen, God has established this whole created order with authority. It started in the garden when he spoke to Adam and said, Adam, I want you to name all the creatures. He gave man authority over all the animals in that way. It's extended even to the relationship between men and women. When Adam not only named the animals, he also named Eve. It's reflected in marriages. It's reflected in our homes. There is an authority structure there that God instituted for good, for our good. There's authority that we have in culture and in our community that we recognize when authorities are doing what they're supposed to do as God's authorities placed there, it is good for the society. What disobedience is listen, it is a rejection of that authority that God has. When you and I disobey God, it is as though we are practicing divination. What does he mean by that? It means, listen, that we are practicing those things which are a recognition of another authority, a godless authority. And we don't want to live like that. That's what we would be demonstrating. God wants you and I to delight in him, not consulting some other authority, divining what way we should go. The pictures of astrology or even like a Ouija board, those types of things, the occult types of things. That's what he says rebellion, disobedience is like, is practicing witchcraft. Why? Because in those moments, you're not seeking God's authority. We're not seeking to hear his voice on a subject. We're listening to some demonic voice, some other authority. And what is the sin of Satan? He didn't want to surrender to God's authority, did he? No, in his pride, he wanted to be the ultimate authority. And what happens is he's brought that down to this earth, and that was his temptation for the man and the woman to make their own decisions, to be the own authority in their life, and not realize it's much better when you and I learn to obey the ultimate authority, who is God himself. Now, parents, listen, we are cultivating that in the hearts of our children, but it's not just what we teach them. We have to model that as well. Our kids need to see in you and see in me, listen, that you know what? We don't just want, well, we'll do what God says. No, no, no. Let's delight to do what God says. Why? Because it's the right way. Because it's the right way which ensures the right end. And it's the right way, listen, that brings joy in our heart because we're living for the purpose for which he made us, which is his glory and not our own. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Sacrifices were never intended to replace obedience. They were never put in that way. But sacrifices are to be an expression of an obedient life. They're a testimony that, listen, I recognize I didn't obey and I need forgiveness. And so, God, I obey you even in this, in offering this sacrifice and saying, please change my heart. Forgive me for my partial obedience. Forgive me for my lack of immediate obedience. Forgive me for my lack of joyful obedience. You see, as the psalmist would say over in Psalm chapter 40, verses 6 through 8, you know, that's a messianic psalm. It's written about who Christ is. And what it says there, it talks about sacrifices and it talks about burnt offerings. And it says, listen, that God doesn't really want those things. What he wants, listen, is for our ear to be dug, pierced. Why? It's a picture of a bondservant. What does a bondservant do? A bondservant delights to do his master's will, to do what he knows his master wants him to do. And the sad thing is, listen, we don't want our ear pierced. Oftentimes, we don't want to do God's will. But there is one who came, listen, and it was written in a book that he delighted to do the Father's will. That's why we gather and worship today. That's why we sang about Jesus earlier. That's why we celebrated and we thank God for the blood that was shed at Calvary. Why? Because that blood was shed in obedience to do the Father's will so that he could pay the penalty for you and I and all the disobedience that we've done doing our own will. Praise the Lord. Now, if I know that and I've repented of my sin and I've placed my faith and trust in him, then my heart should be transformed. My heart should be made new day by day. And here's the amazing thing I've learned. I read this, one of the Puritan fathers talked about this. He said this, you know what? The moment you and I disobey, it's much easier to disobey again. It just gets easier and easier and easier. Our heart gets hardened. But it's the other way too. The moment you obey and go the right way, it's easier to obey the second time and then obey again and again. And God wants you and I on that path. Listen, delighting in obedience. Man, I know I'm going the right way now. I can tell you, I was going the wrong way. Praise God, he turned me around. Man, praise the Lord. And I don't have to delight in disobedience. I can delight in obeying God. I'm going the right way. I'm honoring him. I'm living for his purposes. And those are good purposes and glorious purposes for you and me. And I can live my life that way each day. And what I have to learn to practice is this. You know what? Am I obeying God immediately when the Spirit speaks? When the Spirit speaks to me, this is the practice of godliness. This is why this is better. It's not, well, you know, I need to make up for all the disobedience. No, I'll just give a sacrifice to God. God doesn't want that. He does not want that. What he wants is you and I. Listen to the verse we just read a couple weeks ago, and we studied, and we looked and saw God teaching us about godliness. You remember the living sacrifices? I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present yourself as what? A living sacrifice. Why? Because when I'm a living sacrifice, I am not doing my will. I'm dying to what I want so that I can do, prove what is good and acceptable, the perfect will of God. I can do his will. Obedience, my daily obedience in the little things. Listen, obeying. Man, this is good, obeying God. It's good experiencing his grace and his mercy. It's good experiencing his favor, his smile upon me. It's good to live my life that way, daily, making those choices. A living sacrifice. That's what God wants. That's what obedience is. And as Jesus said, listen, if you love me, you will what? You will keep my commandments. We practice this obedience. We find joy in it. It's not the root of our devotion. It's the fruit that comes from us. Listen, if obedience is the root of our devotion, listen, there's going to be times we disobey. There's going to be times you and I obey. Oh, I got to obey the Lord. He said so. That he doesn't want that either. Man, I get to obey the Lord. Praise God, he's changed my heart. He's made it new. I don't have to go down that old pathway, that dead pathway any longer. I know the right way. I know the right path. God, I love you and I thank you that you opened my eyes and you helped me to realize that Christ died for me and paid the penalty because I couldn't do the right thing every time. And I can trust in that and I can see the transformation taking place. And as I learn to obey you joyfully each time, delighting to do your will as a follower of Christ, that is what brings joy in our hearts. But let me listen. If we don't want to obey him now, what are we going to do in heaven? Think about it for a moment. What are we going to do for eternity? Because there is only obedience of God. I mean, I just read The Great Divorce by C.S. Lewis, and it's not about divorce. It's about heaven and hell and preparing our hearts for heaven. It's an amazing picture, listen, of how God is working in our lives day by day, getting rid of those things, listen, that we used to obey, the things that we used to yield to, the things we used to give our lives to, and realizing the emptiness of them, that they will not, listen, produce anything worthwhile in our lives. And instead, choosing to learn to obey what God says. Now, can I give you the scary part? When Jesus finished the Sermon on the Mount, this is what scares you sometimes. He talked there about the contrast, about trees that bear fruit, good fruit, and trees that bear bad fruit, right? Good fruit comes from good root. Bad fruit comes from bad root, right? He talked about not just the contrast there, but contrast between the man who builds his house on the sand and the one who builds his house on the rock. The man who builds his house on the rock is the one who listens to the word of God and obeys it. And when he does that, that house stands secure. The man who doesn't want to listen to the words, the precepts and principles, his house will go flat when the storms come. But Jesus said this in the midst of those two contrasts. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. Listen to this part. But he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice or do lawlessness. You see, God gives us the truth. He gives us the law. He gives us his precepts. He gives us his principle so you and I can demonstrate, listen, our love for him by obedience, that we really do love him more than whatever this world says to us and offers us. That we love him more than our own desires and what we want in life. And Jesus says, listen, examine your heart, examine your life. Why do you do what you do? Why do we do what we do? Do we do it? Listen, do we do it because God says so? And because we realize it's right and we find joy in it? And our lives have been changed. Or are we doing it for our own reasons? Every man can justify in his own eyes. what's right. But the Lord knows the hearts. And he knows your heart this morning, and he knows my heart. And the principle that should be written there, listen, to obey is better. Let's bow our heads this morning, because maybe we need to get on the altar this morning because we've not been obeying God. There's something that God has even put his finger on in our hearts, in our lives this morning. We realize, you know what, Lord, I've not obeyed you. You've told me to do that, and I've not obeyed you. Forgive me. And I need to get that right with you. I need to make it a priority, Lord, to listen to your voice, to listen to your word. The amazing thing is there's grace and mercy today. There's not a one of us that has obeyed perfectly. That's why Christ had to come. That's why Christ had to come and die and offer himself for our sin, to pay the penalty for our disobedience. But there should be in the heart of the believer a desire, listen, to do the right thing each and every day, resting in what Christ has done for us, but realizing that the Spirit is changing us day by day. Romans 6 says that each day, a believer, we're presenting ourselves as slaves of righteousness. That means we want to obey and do the right thing. It leads to holiness in our life. Do you see that? Is it evident in that? Are you disobeying God in anything today? It could have something to do with your temptations that come to you and you yield to them. Could be a relationship that's not honoring the Lord and he's told you no. Could be a business decision. It could be a decision that you're making and honoring or not honoring your parents. Listen, if we've disobeyed, ask for forgiveness. Ask God for mercy. Ask him, listen, to change your heart, to give you a desire to delight, to obey, to do what God's word says this morning. We run to the cross, and there at the foot of the cross, we kneel and we acknowledge, Lord, I haven't always obeyed, but I want to, because I know your great love that you've given to me. You've shown me. Because of that, Lord, I love you and I want to obey you. Ask for the Lord today to give you a heart that desires to obey him more. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. We're being honest with God, examining our heart today. God wants the sacrifice, listen, of a broken and a contrite spirit. Is our heart yielded to him today? Am I living for my own purposes, my own glory, making monuments to myself, or making monuments to God in obeying him and doing what he's commanded me? Father in heaven, we praise you today. There's grace and there's mercy that flows from your throne. God, we realize we need that, Lord. We haven't obeyed in all ways. Only one did that, our Savior, King Jesus. I pray, Father, everyone under the sound of my voice, here in the sanctuary or listening online or on the radio, God, I pray today that they are resting, trusting in the one who alone established a perfect obedience. But God, as we trust in Jesus and rest in his sacrifice that he offered in our place, God, may it be that our hearts are being renewed day by day. We're putting off the old and we're putting on the new way, a new way of obeying, finding the joy, the delight in that. Discovering, Lord, and as we take steps of obedience, that Lord, you help us to obey the next time with the next choice. God, I pray we would see that fruit of righteousness in our life. I pray it would cleanse our lives and Lord, that we would be a sanctified, set-apart people, demonstrating that we are not children or sons of disobedience any longer, but we're sons of obedience, children of obedience, living for your glory. And Jesus, again, we give thanks for you and that you obeyed the Father perfectly and offered the sacrifice that he required and made us acceptable to him. We ask that you'd help us to live for you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.